So using this system, what we have done was to edit a PDS1 gene in Nicotiana benthamiana. And what we found was that using our QuickPro system, so we were able to edit the PDS1 gene with fairly high frequency. For example, the white callus that you see is the PDS1 two copy edited calli, whereas the green ones may be edited for a single copy or may not be edited for both the copies, right? Then what we did was to test 7 different nucleases in the protoplast system to see which one of the enzyme gives us higher editing frequency. The first one was that, and the second question was like, is there a temperature effect on these editing efficiency using these enzymes? So what we found was that overall, all the enzymes give higher editing efficiency. That's anything from 10% to 60% editing efficiency. So we are talking about like 100,000 cells in which editing efficiency 10 to 60% means. So we have edited 10,000 to 60,000 cells in this system, right? So that's incredible, because you don't have to rely upon any external selection system to screen the cells. So for example, if you look at biolistics or agrobacterium mediated delivery, so you always have to select for the cells, either using a selectable marker or using a gene that codes for fluorescence, right? Whereas here, what we have is like, we don't have any selection system and we are editing at a frequency of 10 to 60%. Then what is important is also like important information here is that we don't find a temperature effect on the editing efficiency. So it can work, these nucleases can work very well at lower temperature as well as higher temperatures. So the next step was like to create the calli from these edited cells in the Nicotiana benthamiana and score for editing efficiency. So what you see here is, for example, from one of the transformation experiment, we have number of calli that were coming in. Since we are editing a GFP gene, for example, so anything that is GFP negative is an edited one, and anything that is GFP positive is not edited, or maybe like one of the alleles is edited and not another allele, right? So what we found was like in terms of like editing efficiencies in the calli. So if you look at nuclease E, so we got over 80% of the calli that were regenerated were edited. Whereas, for example, nucleus G, we have like a incredibly low regeneration efficiency. Then, but we also have like a higher editing efficiency. I mean, incredibly low regeneration efficiency. But we tend to see these editing, these cells edited these cells are edited, right? But if you go back, so our nucleus G is the highest performing in terms of like editing efficiency, but we are not getting the number of cells that were becoming individual calli are planned when we delivered nucleus G, right? So this shows us that higher editing efficiency does not necessarily mean we will recover number of plants, meaning that, so this editing efficiency can be due to like rampant cleavage of the DNA from this nucleus, which is giving us like too much of editing, so that, you know, like it means that it can also cleave a number of sites in the genome, whereas nucleus E tend to be more precise as well as nucleus B. But among nucleus E and nucleus B, there is nucleus E, which seems to be more precise at the same time, giving more precise, leading to higher number of events that were recovered. So like what we then end up doing was like, once we have the platform now for like conducting high throughput, precise genome editing experiments. So what we now are waiting is like some of our data from our experiments related to delivering DNA repair proteins and pathway inhibitors and some of the modifications that we have conducted on the donors. And we have also done a couple of experiments with donor availability by modifying the CRISPR enzyme itself. But we are yet to conduct some of the experiments on cleavage site enrichment with the donor and manipulation of cell cycle by using some reagents that can modify the cell cycle. So summary for like today's presentation is, so we can create traits using random DNA breaks. So those traits can be like iron and zinc or methionine enriched cereal crops, or like can be like vitamin A enriched crops. Then second aspect is like we can edit genomes using Agrobacterium biolistics and RNP delivery by exploiting NHEJ pathway of DNA repair. But what I want to highlight is like you can edit the genome, but whether editing genomes using NHEJ pathway is a wise thing to do. And third summary is that we can perform the precise genome editing of like two nucleotide and three nucleotide insertion, like incorporating information, but at a lower frequency. But only these frequencies can be bumped up if we have a selection system for HDR. But if we don't have a selection system for HDR, then still the HDR efficiency remains to be like low. So what's important like in terms of like getting the technology building platform or like technology evaluation and technology building in itself is to have high throughput systems like a protoplast system, which can allow us to evaluate many different strategies within 1 or 2 days. So this is like an important tool that I would say to come up with the improvement in HDR. Another like aspect that I didn't touch upon in the presentation is about regulations. So I think it seems to be fair in many parts of the world, except for Europe. And we will have to see how this turns out to be in India. So let's hope we will have a sensible regulation, sensible way of looking at genome editing. I think like putting genome editing like in a separate box from transgenics would be like a highly congenial and like a highly adaptable system. So I think like what India has adopted right now is to like put both genome editing and transgenics in one box and then deal them separately. I think like maybe there should be like a newer way of looking at this in the coming days. So with this, finally, like I want to thank many people, particularly Fung, my supervisor in University of Minnesota, Dan Whitus for like all the exchanges that we had working together. And I want to say special thanks to Khan Wong for giving me to expose myself in genome editing. So she was the first one to introduce me to genome editing. I thank my PhD supervisor, Paul Christo. And I also want to thank our CMD from Avastagen Limited, Pilu Moravala Patel, for giving me an opportunity to speak today. And I want to also thank my master thesis supervisor, Dr. D. Sudhakar from Tamil Nadu Agriculture University. So he was the first one to introduce me to plant biotechnology research. So he deserves a lot of credit from my side. So thank you all for listening. And if you have like, I think there are questions in the chat box itself, so I can answer them.
Yes, you can answer a few of them from there.
Yeah, okay. So should I go one by one? Okay. So there is a question called, sir, do you think genome editing can overcome traditional breeding? So the answer is no, because traditional breeding or any other previous technologies are here to stay. And what genome editing can do in agriculture is it can supplement and improve the efficiency at which we were like doing breeding. So that's my take on this. I don't think like any technology that comes in would like simply take away anything that exists, particularly breeding. I don't think that anything will simply take that away. The second question is, what are the chances of acceptance of these transgenic rice in India, Pakistan? We will have to wait and see that. So it's not very clear, like the regulations in India. So I don't know, like how many years of like regulation it takes. I think it's like, given the history of genome transgenic crop approval in India. So we only have a BT rice, BT cotton, but we don't have any crop yet that is commercialized. So I think it will be like quite difficult to get approval to, you know, allow farmers to grow transgenic crops in India. How does CRISPR-Cas genome editing compare to other genome editing tools? I think I have answered this in the presentation itself. So third one, next one is, have you used virus-mediated delivery of genome editing components? No, I haven't used virus-mediated delivery of genome editing reagents, because if you use virus-mediated delivery, most likely, I mean, it's an incredible tool, virus-mediated delivery, for building technologies. But I was more focused on like creating technologies that go to the field. So using virus for gene delivery means the product will never come out. Then, how efficient is CRISPR-Cas9 deletion of harmful mutagenic genes? I mean, it can be incredibly efficient. So you can say anything from 50 to 100% efficiency. Which one is more efficient approach for genome editing agrobacterium or biolistics? So this is more of an hypothetical question. So it also depends on crop. For example, there are crops that you cannot transform by agrobacterium. So you have to rely on biolistics. So in that system, biolistics is efficient. So there are crops that you can transform with agrobacterium and biolistics. So you can still see a fairly good amount of efficiency in both the systems. So I just wonder if there is any paper that is available that compares with the statistical conclusion that one system is better than other system. So here comes a black rice question where zinc and iron is higher. That's from Kumar Saurabh Singh. So can we edit the black rice? I think, yeah, I mean, you can edit as long as you have a protocol for gene delivery, reagent delivery, and regeneration. So that's perfectly possible. Can one edit a damaged DNA? So what is the main impact of genome editing? So can Amici Dennis. So I would like to, I mean, if this person can write me an email asking, clarifying a little bit on, can one edit damaged DNA? I mean, what does they mean by damaged DNA? So what I assume now is like, can you edit a broken DNA? I mean, it's, yeah, you can edit a broken DNA if the damaged DNA refers to broken DNA in the genome. What explanation do we have for the presence of large random DNA fragments when performing CRISPR gene editing ballistic transmission? I think this is a very good question. So one of the explanation is like, you have two possibilities going on in ballistics. One is it uses physical force and you are cleaving the DNA using that physical force. And second thing is we are using RNP molecules along with the selectable marker plasmid. So since there is something called MMEJ mediated editing that happens, and also we know that CRISPR can also tolerate up to 5-6 mismatches for editing. So particularly the Cas9 that we have used is wild type Cas9 that can tolerate up to 6-7 mismatches. So I can definitely say that either the plasmid DNA that we were using is edited by CRISPR off target effect. And also there are like certain fragments that were generated by the physical force that was used by the biolistics. So what is the frequency of double strand break? 3 base pair from the PAM. So maybe it's from Jainul Khan. Think like you can get fairly good efficiency if you are using using Cas9. So because it cleaves right after 3 base pair, so you can get incredibly high efficiency of cleavage. So among various delivery methods, which method can be able to deliver with high precision and high efficiency? So I mean, like, so the precision in genome editing refers to how precisely you can repair the DNA. So I would call precision genome editing as when you perform homology directed repair. High efficiency you can get from both agrobacterium and biologistics. So even though, you know, like you can get, you can have like 70% by RNP delivery and 60-70% by biologistic DNA delivery, then 80% or 90% by agrobacterium. So depending on the purpose and the intellectual properties that you are surrounded with, you can adopt any of those methods. Why limited use of CRISPR genome editing in millet crops? I think maybe, you know, the millet crops are more grown in India and other countries, since genome editing is still picking up in these countries. So hopefully we will see more CRISPR-Cas based papers coming out in millet crops from several of these countries. So why do we use Cas9 RNP plus HDR? So I think the use of RNP plus HDR template was to create more of a non-transgenic approach of genome editing, so that, you know, like we will have a system that is like can be like utilized for commercial scale up. That is the reason why we used RNP and HDR delivery reagents. Is there any other method to detect mutation in CRISPR-Cas9 mediated genome editing except the T7 endonuclease assay and sequencing? If you are sequencing, T7 endonuclease assay doesn't necessarily, you don't necessarily need it, but you can simply do a PCR and you have a restriction site, you can use the restriction site, more like an RFLP. So again, coming to the point where someone asked if CRISPR is going to like overtake plant breeding. No,